Hey everyone, welcome back to another PC port review. Today we're looking at Baldur's Gate 3. Now I know there's going to be a few of you in the comment section, it's not a PC port, Alex, it's designed on PC first and it's getting ported to consoles later. Yeah, I know, it's just the name of the series. It's fine. You don't have to have a conniption in the comment section because of it. Now I'm going to be seeing those comments the entire time, so congrats to me for playing myself. Anyways, Baldur's Gate 3 is developed and published by Larian Studios. The description reads, Baldur's Gate 3 is a story-rich, party-based RPG set in the universe of Dungeons & Dragons, where your choices shape a tale of fellowship and betrayal, survival and sacrifice, and the lure of absolute power. Baldur's Gate 3 is $59.99 in a single-player online co-op, LAN co-op, Steam cloud saves. There is controller support, by the way, and it is DRM free. So that's really, really big because Larian has done, in my opinion, really amazing work so far. Now in the main menu, we are about 96% GPU usage to about 98. So we got a little bit of headroom left, just a couple percentage points, nothing too bad. VRAM allocated is 6.3, dedicated is 4.01. For the CPU, we're about 22% total usage, but there are certain cores and threads that are hitting quite high and some not even hitting at all. So CPU usage may be a big hindrance for some of you in this game. Cores like 13, 15, 16 are classic favorites, as well as 7 and 3 in the 40 to 50%, while cores like 2, 6, 8, 10, 12, all the even ones are sitting at 1%, single digits, or even 0%, which is kind of crazy. So there's going to be some optimization needed for the CPU side of this game, in my personal opinion. Now, we are using the Vulkan renderer. In my personal testing, Vulkan has been much easier on, let's say, performance than DX11 has been, especially with a lot of like things going off on screen. It's not perfect, but Vulkan for me has performed quite better. It could be also the fact that I'm running a full AMD system, but if you have the option to go Vulkan, my suggestion is you do so over DX11. We are seeing about 14 gigs of RAM being used, 1.6 gigs dedicated, and we are touching around 190 FPS in just the main menu. So like we do with every PC port review, let's go over the options settings. Now, this options menu is honestly the best. I am so happy with this because it is literally addressing all the issues that I've had with so many games coming to PC in the first place. Online visibility, there's an actual drop-down. It's not this weird, like, left-to-right console interface with a mouse GUI over it. This is an actual PC user interface, and it's honestly fantastic to see. Online visibility, LAN connection, direct connection if you want to do that as well. Auto-saves, maximum number of auto-saves, quick saves as well, cross-saves. Honestly, I would disable this because the Larian servers for actually backing up your saves for cross saves have been kind of funky lately. So if you're just on Steam right now, just keep with the Steam cloud saves, just disable the Larian cross saves. So you should be fine with that moving forward, unless you are switching between console and PC. Hopefully they'll iron that out within the next month or so if you're gonna get this on PS5 and PC as well. Show genitals, absolutely. Make them big, thick, and hard. Cinematic nudity, yes. Private moments, we are not going to share those. That's going to be just for me only, by the way, guys. That's going to be my alone time. Exploration highlights, if you want to do that, which is honestly fantastic. Circle and highlights, turn-based highlights, tactical view highlights, system of measurement, if you want to do metric or imperial. You know, we're in America, baby. Metric system, that's not a real thing. You know what I'm saying? No, I'm joking for the EU boys. Karmic dice, we have that as well. Auto select character after combat, which is nice to see. Lock mouse to window, because this is a DX11 game, but even so, it is using a fake full screen, so locking the mouse to window is really nice because then it keeps everything where it needs to be if you're a multi-monitor user, so I really am happy with that. Edge panning if you want to play with that as well, but WASD does move the camera for you. Panning speed, we can increase that too. Dynamic combat area, camera shakes, follow flying creatures, enable Twitch extensions. The Twitch extension is honestly fantastic. And I love the fact that there's a description here on the right-hand side with all of that as well of what it actually does, which is nice to see. So keybinds, you have full rebindable keybinds. Awesome. Love it. You also have it on your controller as well if you want to use a controller for this game too, where you can rebind every button on top of that. So this is just standard, run-of-the-mill, love-to-see-it kind of a thing. Video options. So this is where I usually have a meltdown and freak out and start screaming about things, but not this time. Larian Studios is putting people to shame, and I love it. 7900 XT for the adapter, for display, for the actual monitor. We're using DisplayPort 16:9. You also have 16:10 for our widescreen boys. I don't know if it has ultra widescreen right now, but I'm sure you can just hack that in there if you'd like to. 1440p, we're playing at 144 hertz for the refresh rate. Full screen, even though, like I said before, it's not dedicated full screen. It is windowed full screen, even the setting. Blocking your mouse cursor is always a nice thing. VSync I have disabled just for testing as well. But look at this. The second we hover over VSync, there is a preview of what it actually looks like and what it actually does. Enabled and disabled and a descriptor. Amazing. Why is this so hard for other games to do? But Larian Studios, a little dev team of 50 to 100 people, gets it done. Shocking to me. We set the preset to custom, so you can take a look at it for model quality. You can see low, medium, or high. You can see detail distance. I would have liked to see that here as well, Larian. We need to see that too for LOD. For instance distance, you can see that too. All the differences there. Texture quality, really nice to see. Texture filtering, I would have liked to see that here as well. So we are getting some things, but we're not getting other things. So animation level of detail for high, HDD, dynamic crowds. These things should be here showing about what it'll look like if you want to add dynamic crowds, or also the kind of impact it'll take on your VRAM, CPU, and GPU. Sorry for knocking the mic over for a quick second. So even though it's good, even though it's better, there's still things to add in my personal opinion. Shadow quality as well, cloud quality, fog quality, post-processing. It does have AMD FSR 1.0, which honestly, I'm not a really big fan of. I would prefer to have 2.1. And you'll see how it impacts the Steam Deck as well, because when you add FSR, it does have this sort of like fuzzy haze to it, and it's not as good as everything else. And I don't see DLSS, and I'm not sure if DLSS is not here just because it has FSR or if because I'm just using an AMD GPU. So I have to do some more research on that, but I think it's only using AMD FSR 1.0 at the very moment, from my understanding. I could be wrong, but just be aware of that. Sharpness, you're going to want to increase that if you're using FSR. Just giving you guys a heads up. Anti-aliasing, we are going to have none, because I honestly can't stand TAA, MSA, or DLAA, or FXAA. It always looks this really weird Vaseline covered thing on my screen. I'd rather deal with the jaggies with a higher resolution than deal with any sort of anti-aliasing. I mean, occlusion is there, so you can see all the shadows and the rocks and things like that. Depth of field, we shut that off on this channel. I'm sorry. That gets turned off. God rays stay on because I think they look good. Bloom and subsurface scattering as well. But I love the fact that we have actual visual representation of what it's going to look like. I would have liked to see CPU usage, GPU usage, and VRAM consumption. Would have also been nice to see as well. And also DLSS and FSR 2.1. Not a bad options menu in terms of graphics, but not perfect. So I'm going to give this a B minus for that in terms of visual settings for this game. Much better than what we've normally seen, but still could have been an improvement. Master sound volume, sound effects, user interface, ambient music, voice, character, dynamic range. Mute sound when inactive, which is kind of nice to hear as well. So if you alt-tab, it's not too bad. Point-and-click voice frequency, always. Occlusion quality, high, center to dynamic audio. And then force mono audio if you need that as well. For interface, this is really great because now you can actually see the different changes of what happens when you make those adjustments in your UI. So if you want to do automatic input mode, which is nice to see here, show pings, tutorials, show full tooltips, subtitles, speaker, text background, opacity, dialogue text size, which is great. I love big old fonts. I like the big old PS2 fonts like we had back in the day. That's my favorite console. Overhead text size as well. Add arrows automatically, consumables automatically for hotbar options as well. So you can add those things too if you want to do that kind of stuff. So you can have that in your hotbar. You don't have to add it to yourself, but it's always just going to be there. And then accessibility, which is always really nice for input mode, long pressing and holding, showing genitals. I wonder why that's accessible. It should always be accessible. Camera shake, auto rotate camera, show subtitles, speaker, stuff like that. Really, really nice. The fact that it is a full on PC UI interface. It has a perfect mouse GUI. It has a lot of great stuff that I really complain about, but some small things need to be adjusted. So again, not perfect, not horrible, definitely a B minus, but really, really good out of the gate so far. Let's do a couple of things. I want to show you guys two quick sections, the open world area, quote unquote, and then also just sort of like the cavernous area and how it performs. So let's jump in game. I'm not going to spoil anything story-wise. I just want to show some of the main open world and then show you guys like a little combat section to see how it performs in terms of that sort of thing. The characters you'll see are going to be in the very first hour, 2 hours of the game. So there's nothing spoiling it for you here, so don't be concerned about that. But in the open world, in the actual map in-game, we're hitting about 141 FPS, 97% GPU usage, 6 gigs of VRAM allocated, 4.6 dedicated. CPU temperature is climbing in the 69, nice, to about 70 degrees, but usage has jumped to about 30%. But certain cores and threads are really just peeking out at me. CPU core 16 jumped to like the 80%, then fell back down to the 30s. 15 as well is freaking out around 50 to 60 and just hit 88% to 92%. So we got certain cores and threads getting hit really hard and then falling back down. So just be aware of that. I feel like this is going to be more CPU intensive than GPU because of just everything happening in the game and all the calculations being made in the background. But again, I think that it's not terrible, but there are some slight stutters as well, as you can see on the frame time graph on the bottom left. It's not a perfectly smooth experience, especially when moving the camera in the open world area. So let's see if we can just get this torn net trap over here. The frame time graph could be better, and we are playing it at a, you know, not a locked frame rate, which could be the issue as well. So turning the camera does have quite a few frame time issues of stutters. You can see when I'm turning that camera here. And I really feel it has more to do with quite a few things that are happening in the game in terms of visuals as well as the CPU. CPU usage. Let's see if we can create that stutter over and over again. So it happens when you're turning the camera. So there needs to be some definite big optimizations on this game. I don't think it was ready for total prime time release right now. But let's go ahead and turn on FSR 2.1, because some of the other things that I've seen was that you can sort of like, quote unquote, fix this, not really, with FSR, and that could make things a little bit better. It's not as spiky as it was before, but still moving the camera to certain sections does create still a bit of a stutter, especially when you're moving through the open world. So you are going to be noticing that kind of a thing. But even then, our frame rate jumped about 30 FPS from turning FSR 1.0 on. So it's not a bad jump, but again, now CPU core 3 is at 70 to 86%, core 7, 68, core 13, 71, core 15, 94%. We definitely have a CPU issue with usage in this game, and it is really getting pushed quite hard. So I think if you're going to have a lower end CPU, you're going to have a bit of a tougher time with this game than you would normally. And I think that's going to be an issue in terms of just actually working through it and just optimization that's going to be needed. So let's turn this back off for FSR. And as you can see now, CPU usage is then dropped from it because we are lowering the resolution with FSR to get a higher frame rate. So, you know, it's still a bit of a concern for me, because on a 7700X, getting pinged at around 97% usage on a CPU core isn't a fun time at all, by the way, and really shouldn't be happening, or hitting 90% usage right now on core 15. So we're seeing odd cores really get hit hard and even cores not get hit at all. So like core 10, core 6, and even core 2 are sitting at like 10% usage. What? Kind of wild. And then of course, having the open world stutter really does cause an issue like that. Now, if we were to lock the frame rate to frame rate cap, let's lock it to 60. Even with the frame rate locked, we still get that stutter moving that camera around in the open world, which is not a great experience. So even though we had a great options menu, even though we're locking the frame rate to 60, we've alleviated a lot of the GPU usage. There are still issues with CPU usage, like core 3 hitting 85 to 90% at some points. Really wild. And core 16 hitting 98% usage. There is an absolute CPU bottleneck in this game, even with a 7700X. And I don't think just throwing money at this is going to solve this issue. Even if you have a much higher end CPU, this is definitely going to be a problem with some of you guys. And it does show in the Steam Deck version as well. Now, with that being said, let's jump into the Dank Crypt, because it is the most dank of dankness. So you guys can see what that's like when you are in sort of like a caverned area where it's not so open world. Let's see if something shows up there. But again, in the open areas, you're going to be getting quite a bit of stutter when you're panning the camera quite quickly. And that's really not a great experience in my personal opinion, because this game should be far better optimized than what we currently have. So even in the caves, though, we're not getting as big of a stutter as we did outside, but it is slightly there. There are some small micro stutters that you're seeing here. And I've already beaten this section, but I'm not going to spoil anything here. As you can see, though, there are going to be some slowdowns when you move that camera and you pan it. You can see the frame rate kind of like struggling to catch up. And that's a CPU issue from what I'm seeing here. It's just a shame because this game is honestly completely amazing. But these small little inconsistencies are a bit of a concern. Now, when we uncap the frame rate and go fully hog wild, we're at 250 FPS inside of a dungeon. And it does feel smoother. It absolutely does. But again, you're going to have those small micro stutters moving around and playing around in that area. So just be cautious of that and just be expecting of that. I really think they should be patching this quite soon. But again, you're going to be CPU limited depending upon your current setup. So I really feel like you're going to need a beefier CPU than what you may currently already have. So if you're having issues where your game is crashing or things along those lines, this game, as good as it is, in my opinion, I still feel like this version still needs a lot of work comparative to what we are expecting or what my expectations are from Larian as well. So I don't want to really do anything too wild. As you can see, we just had a bit of a stutter the second I turned that off real quick. And it's just not, it's not up to par, in my personal opinion, for what my expectations are for this game. So I'm going to give that performance a C on itself because it really isn't right in the sense of terms of, even though the options menu is good, everything else is good, the game is phenomenal by its own. Having those small performance issues, having the CPU cores function this way, hitting 1% or 2% is not advantageous and it is not good for people with lower end hardware. Even though a lot of the minimum recommended specs aren't out of this world. So that's on that end. I don't want to do much more because I don't want to spoil it, but it is pretty consistent across the board, even in combat. Now, certain areas where you are going to have a lot of actual effects, you will see stutters there as well. Just like we saw outside in the main open world. It's not insanely dramatic or as bad as something like Forspoken, but it's noticeable and it's definitely a hindrance. So I really hope that Larian does much better in terms of optimization for this, because it is a great game being hampered by its performance woes right now. And that's just my personal opinion on that. As good as this game is, it has issues. So let's do this. Let's test it on the Steam Deck, because people are telling me it's good, people are telling me it's bad, and I'm going to give you an actual objective answer on that. Let's jump into that now. So here we are in the Steam Deck version of Baldur's Gate. Now, it's going to look much more pixelated because of the fact it's running off the Steam Deck, connected to an Elgato, then put on my PC. But on the deck, it does look very good. However, because of FSR 1.0, it's going to look very blurry. And the automatic settings that you get when you start this game are not great at all. But in the main menu, 92% GPU usage, 40% CPU usage is average, which is pretty good compared to what we saw on the main PC. You're only going to get about an hour and a half to maybe 2 hours total gameplay time on this thing. Mostly because, boy, this thing makes a Steam Deck heat up like nobody's business. We are adding triple buffering with VSync on because we need it. We have internally capped the frame rate inside of the game to 40 FPS, and then you can lock that to 40 in terms of the actual hertz on the Steam Deck itself. And that should give you some better representation. Now, I put detail distance to medium, but model quality I set to low. Pretty much everything else I set to low, and then texture quality to medium. I did add texture filtering for anisotropic filtering. Level of detail for animation is set to medium. Everything else is medium or low. It's just needs to be that way because of the way this thing operates. FSR 1.0 I set to quality for sharpening. For FX I turned off, but internally for sharpening itself, all the way up. Like, it has to be all the way up or else you're going to have a bad time. Like, it's just going to be a bad time, man. And you'll see the difference as well, because you'll see that with a lot of the hair particles and hair things inside the game. And you'll see that here too. So let's just jump into the open world like we were before. And then I can show you guys how it actually runs when you're really panning the camera and the kind of performance you actually are going to get when you're in game. So I'll float anywhere around between 40 FPS to about mid to high 20s. So you hit 20, 29, and you'll jump to 40, depending upon the area and how long things take to load. Loading in this game will take quite a bit longer as well, because this is playing off of the SSD, but there is a bit of texture load too, comparative to what we normally have in other games. So let's go ahead and get that set up. You may even hear the jet engine roaring. So we're getting around 28 FPS. Not really the best in terms of like performance. So 31, 32, 33. I feel like this is going to be sort of like the last resort into playing this game. It does look much more pixelated because FSR is active while also being pumped through a 1280 by 800 through an Elgato. So please don't vomit all over your desk or over your phone. We are getting some stutters already just crowding in the open world. And, you know, it's not a great experience. I don't expect this to be a way to play this game, honestly. If you were going to play this on a handheld, my personal opinion would be to have it stream from the PC to your Steam Deck and not play it natively, because even though it is turn-based, you'll have a better experience and a better frame rate than you would if you tried to do it this way. It's just really not what I would consider to be a playable game, even though at some points you're getting to 40 FPS, which good, but not ideal and not great, which is kind of a problem, especially with the dips that we're getting into the 29s, like I said before. So it's not... If you have no other option to playing this game, it's not great. It's definitely not great. This needs a lot of work. And again, we're seeing it with the CPU cores. CPU cores 3, 5, and even 6 are hitting 100% sometimes. This is a CPU issue, in my opinion, compared to a GPU one, even though the GPU is flushed. This just needs some work. I am running this off Proton 8.0-3. Which you can just download directly through Steam instead of using Proton 7. Also, some other people that I talked to about Steam Deck stuff and Linux have been saying Proton Experimental works very well as well. So just be aware of that. You might have some concerns. You might have some issues with this. Performance is very erratic and not really the best where it needs to be. Definitely needs some big time help. Let's go into the chapel here, which you'll see in the beginning, and you can figure out what it's going to look like when you're in a dungeon, and then have that experience for you guys as well, so you guys can get that idea. So it's gonna run better when you're inside. Oh, I just got tangled. Great. Saving throw, come on. Let's go. Thank you. That's what I get for not having enough of a saving throw in a roll. Good job, Alex. Let's go ahead and load into this dungeon. Now in the dungeon, you're gonna get a much more stable frame rate, obviously. But even then, it's not super stable because look at that frame time graph. Even though we're not going to be dipping into the low, you know, the mid to high 30s or the like high 20s around there, 20, 29, you're going to be hitting the 40s much easier if you lock it to the 40 FPS mark. And even in some sections may even get 60, but it's not ideal. It's not a good way to play this game. It needs optimization. It definitely is not ready for Steam Deck, in my personal opinion. Even though this game took some time in the oven and it's very well done, there's massive opportunity here for optimization in terms of CPU and even GPU and even Steam Deck stuff as well. So hopefully there will be a couple of fixes through Proton. Hopefully that'll fix things up as well. Can I recommend this game? If you can look past the stuttering issues when you're in the main area with your PC and the camera, if you have a beefy enough CPU, then sure, I would pick it up, but I would also be very wary of it, even though it is $60 by itself. My personal opinion, I think Larian has done a really great job. There are a lot more objectively good things about what Larian has done compared to what we've seen with other games that cost the same or more. I would give this a B minus total, mostly because Larian has stated there's no microtransactions, which are none in here. It's a fully complete game. They are obviously going to be working on it. I'm being a little bit more lenient with it because of how good the actual game really is. But again, if stutters are a big thing for you, I would wait. It needs some optimization patches before you guys spend that hard-earned money on there. If you're willing to look past that, then sure, pick it up, because you're not going to be disappointed if you can look past it. However, though, in my personal opinion of staying objective and staying consistent, there needs to be a lot of optimizations, and this is a B-, C-plus sort of port or version of this game. that needs a lot of work. And I feel like the console versions are also going to be having a bit of an issue as well. But with that being said, let me know what you guys think in the comment section down below. If you like this kind of content, you want to see more, subscribe to the channel. We are getting so close to 50,000 subscribers, and it really does mean a lot, so I appreciate that. We are doing more gaming news, PC port reviews, Steam Deck videos, emulation content, fanboy videos, and live streams every Saturday. I'm also going to be streaming more Path of Exile as well, so you'll see that tonight on the actual channel. We'll be doing some pinnacle bosses for Endgame, so check it out. If you want to see more of that content, subscribe. Like I said, thank you very much. If you want to become a member of the community, join the Discord, or get access to emotes, just become a YouTube member. It is as low as $1. If you don't want to spend the dollar, don't worry about it. It's all good. Just thank you for watching all the way to the end and even showing up to live streams. That means more to me than anything. But with that being said, y'all, hope you have a great one, and I'll see you next time.